वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। नारायणं नमस्कृत्यं नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरे नष्टप्रायेषु अभद्रेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया भगवती उत्तमश्लोके भक्तिर्भवती नैष्टिकी। सो वी आर रीडिंग टुडे फ्रॉम द श्रीमद् भागवतम कैंटो 10 चैप्टर 61 टेक्स्ट नंबर 4 स्मयाव लोकलव दर्शित भाव हरि भ्रूमंडल प्रहित सौरत मंत्र शौंदे पंत्यस्तु षोडश सहस्रम अनंग बाने यसेन्द्रियं विमतुं विमतितुं करने नशेकु स्मयावलोकलव दर्शित भाव हरि भ्रूमंडल प्रहित सौरत मंत्र शौंदे पंत्यस्तु षोडश सहस्रम अनंग बाने यसेन्द्रियं विमतितुं करने नशेकु स्मयावलोकलव दर्शित भाव हरि भ्रूमंडल प्रहित सौरत मंत्र शौंदे पंत्यस्तु षोडश सहस्रम अनंग बाने यस्येन्द्रियं विमतितुं करने नशेकु। मंडल प्रहित सौरत मंत्र सौंदे अस्तु षोडश सहस्रम आमे स्मयावलोकलव दर्शित भाव हरि मंडल प्रहित सौरत मंत्र शौंदे पंत्यस्तु षोडश सहस्रम अनंग बाने यस्येन्द्रियं विमतितुं करने नशेकु स्मयावलोकलव दर्शित भावहारि भ्रूमंडल प्रहित सौरत मंत्र शौंदे पंत्यस्तु षोडश सहस्रम असंध्यं विमतितुं करने नशेकु माताजी स्मयो विथ कंसील्ड लाफ्टर अवलोक of glances. Lover, by the traces. Darshita, displayed. Bhava, by the intentions. Hari, enchanting. Bhru, of the eyebrows. Mandala, by the arch. Prahita, sent forth. Saurata, romantic. Mantra, of messages. Shaunde, with the manifestations of boldness. Pantya, wives. Tu, but. Shodasha, 16. Sahasram, 1,000. Ananga, of Cupid. Bane, with the arrows. Yasya, whose. Indriyam, senses. Vimatitum, to agitate. Karane, and by other means. Na sheku, were unable. Translation: the arched eyebrows of these 16,000 queens enchantingly expressed those ladies' secret intentions through coyly smiling sidelong glances. Thus, their eyebrows boldly sent forth conjugal messages. Yet even with these arrows of Cupid, and with other means as well, they could not agitate Lord Krishna's senses. No purport, so text 5. Translation: thus these women obtained as their husband the master of the goddess of fortune, although even great demigods like Lord Brahma do not know how to approach him. With ever increasing pleasure, they felt loving attraction for him, exchanged smiling glances with him, eagerly anticipated associating with him in ever fresh intimacy, and enjoyed in many other ways. Purport: this text describes the intense conjugal attraction the queens felt for Lord Krishna. Text 6. Translation: although the Supreme Lord's queens each had hundreds of maidservants, they chose to personally serve the Lord by approaching him humbly, offering him a seat, worshipping him with excellent paraphernalia, bathing and massaging his feet, giving him pan to chew, fanning him, anointing him with fragrant sandalwood paste, adorning him with flower garlands, dressing his hair, arranging his bed, bathing him, and presenting him with various gifts. Purport by the disciples of His Holiness, His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Srila Sridhar Swami explains that Sukadeva Goswami is so eager to describe these glorious pastimes of the Lord with his queens that he has repeated these verses. That is, text 5 of this chapter is almost identical with text 44 of the 59th chapter in this canto, and text 6 is identical with text 45 of that chapter. Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti explains that the term vararhana, which means excellent offerings, indicates that the queens offered the Lord palmfuls of flowers, pushpanjali, and palmfuls of jewels, ratnanjali. Om Agyan Timirandasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Malitam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam. Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale Srimati Bhaktivedanta Swami Tinamine. Namaste Saraswati Deva Gauravani Prachayana Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschata Deshatarine. So in this texts, the essence that we hear and what we will talk briefly about is the wonderful service attitude, the mentality of the queens. Actually, when we read these verses, it sounds very natural
And it is natural because that is the natural propensity. But if you were to just trace back to when I was reading this, I was just trying to think that when was the time when this made immediate sense to me, and what was it just before that? So, and then why was that? That which is the case with most people, that you know, we when we hear the word servant, for instance, service and servant, it sounds so strange and embarrassing, probably initially. You know, that, and then to say servant of the servant is making it, compounding it. So the thing is that we, the root that of our scriptures, which has been repeatedly explained to us, is that there is only one universal dharma, and there are many faiths. So it is these faiths, you know, whether we, one might say, I don't like this faith, I don't like your faith, somebody says, I don't like your faith, and someone says, I like your faith, I like my faith, everything is fine, everything is together. So there is different opinions, and if you remember that when this most simple question was asked, that for everything in life we look for an expert, right? When we when we want to learn music, you know, we will go to the same particular school and study under the particular teacher and practice accordingly under instructions. For anything that we for carpentry or for physics or for medicine, for business, whatever practice we do, whatever occupation we do, we go to an expert. But it is only in the case of religion that people generally have their own opinions. They do not go to the relevant authentic sources. So this is the fundamental principle which really makes it difficult for us to go to the root, and then we only take it that, well, religion means faith, and faith means I believe what I believe, and very few people in fact would even actually go to the essence. So from that, then linking it to their own cultures and their mannerisms, their various details, rituals, which are all relevant, but not tying it up to the essential cause, becomes a problem. So if we see, the universal dharma is Sanatana dharma, and as it is said that dharmantu shakshat bhagavat pranitam, so it is actually the word of God. Word of God means that it is God's opinion, Krishna's opinion, that counts, not our opinion, not his opinion, her opinion. And what he says, that actually it becomes religion. Religion is what God believes, not what we believe. So therefore we have to understand what God is trying to tell us, and what is the principle. And that's when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu mentions that Jivara Swarupa Hoy, Krishna and Nitya Das, which is really the essential propensity that we have, because these propensities everybody has, a natural propensity. The propensity to serve is really, to serve Krishna is the basis for every living entity. We may not know it in most cases, but that is a fact. So dharma actually, we can say, is the absolute law of God, but is also the natural propensity, the swadharma of the individual living entity for the very essence of the living entity. So and by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's direction, we understand that, we also know what that swadharma is, that essentially the nature is to serve, and to serve Krishna. Now, how do we serve is also mentioned, because it is not just the quality of the service is also what is important, because that quality of the service will really define the which gives the real pleasure to the soul. And that quality is, as Bhagavatam describes, it should be unmotivated and uninterrupted. Ahaitoki ahapratehita. Otherwise, we may also have our own interpretations of how that service should be. So, to whom? That is, to the Lord. How? Should be uninterrupted, unmotivated. So, within these parameters, And if when we say it is the essence, the essential nature of a living entity, which means, puzzling as it may sound initially, that actually, because we don't relate it to our daily activities. Say, we get up and we read newspapers, or we may go to work, and then we come back, and then we have our family and we have other obligations and so on. And then we say, where is this? I don't understand. You say that, I understand I am the soul. But what is it that when you say essential nature, is it at a different age or is it a different era? Was it earlier and not now? This is eternal. The axiomatic principles, the truths are eternal at all times. So actually that is where the need of guidance, scriptures and the purification of our soul comes, when we need to understand this, make this connection. First make the connection, understand, and then how we can slowly incorporate in our lives. Because once you make that, then everything starts falling into place. That how do we connect to what is our Swadharma, as we understand from the scriptures, we come to a stage where we believe in it. But then when we actually understand that service is everything. So, first principle to understand is that when we say that service to Krishna is the essence of every living being, but misdirected service is really what we see everywhere. Because we also don't normally realize that actually everybody is serving. Everybody means everybody. Every person on this world, in this world, would be serving. You say, how some people may say, I'm not serving, I'm actually the my president of my company, so others serve me. But you serve your family, you serve the country, you serve, by following the laws you serve the country, you serve the community, and you certainly serve your senses and mind. So whether we talk of government service, government, somebody may say, I'm the prime minister of the country. But the prime ministers may say, I'm serving the, at least he's supposed to be serving the country. So there is always a need to serve. And one is the external, but even if we don't have, even if somebody is in the forest, somebody is away from society, but you cannot get away from the thing that you're under the clutches or surrendered to your mind and senses. This is so finally you can't get away from the fact that you're led by the way your mind tells you to, you're led by the way your senses guide you. So this is where, so service means you serve where you surrender. So basically the misdirection of that is the key problem. So once we understand that every person is serving, it's only a question of whether you choose to serve the Lord, or you choose to serve. If you don't choose to serve the Lord, the alternatives are that we will be serving, be guided by, be an unguided missile. Just at our own whims, the way we want to do it, the way we think it is. And it will be very difficult to discriminate between whether our mind is telling us this or whether it is the truth. And we will continue doing that. So that's where the confusion lies. So once we understand that it is the direction is the key, and in that direction how to tie it up to all our activities in the service of the Lord is the essence of living a God conscious life or a Krishna conscious life. That is why Prabhupada may call this International Society for Krishna Consciousness. The society, just like we have a cooperative society in a house, housing society, that society's principle is that okay, all the members meet together and they frame the laws of the how to live in a society, what the charges are, who will pay the expenses, and so on. So he called it international. This society is only, the seven principles, essentially is the main principle is to spread the word of God, to get people to love God, irrespective of what their faith is. Whether it is, Christians or Jains or Buddhists or Muslims or whatever, as long as they can connect to the real essence of what their religion says, this is what we are, so Sanatana Dharma is basically rises above all other, all religions, all faiths. And where do we see these perfect examples? And that these examples we see in the scriptures. The scriptures are meant to, and particularly in the Bhagavatam, we have, several, not only the incarnation of the Lord, but with every time we see the perfect examples. for instance, just Narsingh Chaturdashi has just gone, so we had some excellent lectures and understanding of Narsingh Dev and his life, his avatar. So, and Prahlad Maharaj is one such who's a perfect example, because we know how much he was. There was, nobody could even rival Hiranyakashipu in terms of power and influence, and he tried to kill his own son. And but because Prahlad had complete full faith in the Lord, and he demonstrated it, because whatever he whatever the situation is, he was completely unmoved because of the faith. And eventually, when Narsingh Dev kills Hiranyakashipu, and then actually only Prahlad can pacify him, and then he's so overwhelmed, and he has so much of his joy overflows to see Prahlad. When even all the demigods were trembling, they couldn't control his anger. And when Lord Narsingh Dev insists that he wants to give benediction, and Prahlad does not want to take, and Lord Narsingh Dev is saying that I can give you the throne of Indra. I would like to give you the throne of Indra. Okay, if not that, then I will give you eternal residence in the Vaikuntha planets. You can be my confidential associate there, a servant. Or you can be, I can give eternal liberation for eternity from this cycle. But Prahlad, then what is his wonderful reply, which is the basis of what we are talking of, the service, that my Lord, I am not here to do business. I am not here, I am just, I am not a businessman. I am only here to serve you, and my greatest privilege and my greatest pleasure is to serve you. So therein lies the secret, that where we have to find, we have to understand that devotional service is a rare privilege. It's actually not only a rare privilege, but it is a, it's our right. It's a right of every living entity, and it is a privilege and it's very rare. Why is it rare? Because if we see all around us, all materialistic activities are basically karma bandhan activities. They're binding us. Anything we do is, whether it's mode of goodness, passion or ignorance, so we're going to be bound by it. But devotional service takes us away from this, takes us up and above from that. And it is done, if done in the spirit of without motivation, because that is a key, because our this is where we also need guidance, because as we go into Krishna consciousness and we try to be sincere, the challenges become more subtle. Initially they are the gross challenges, and we initially, it's like Abhimanyu's Chakravyuh. You go one circle, then you break and you go to the next, and then you go to the next and the next, and you get so the first one may be our four senses, and we have to control it, and then we achieve it, we feel we have climbed a big hill, and we feel, but then we realize that actually, when we realize, only when we are actually sincerely following that for some time, we actually realize that what we've climbed is actually nothing. It is not, this is actually a basic human being's a basis for a human being. Then we come across more and more subtle challenges, and in that, this challenge of feeling that we have done something is very difficult to get away from. So Prahlad Maharaj is giving the highest example of that for eternity. Lord Narsingh Dev came in a different yuga to actually demonstrate, and now it, for his establish his fame forever, saying how Prahlad is a pure devotee and his most loving son. So in spite of that, and when the Lord is insisting, sometimes when we want something, we will say no, because we know we're trained to do the right thing, but our heart may say something else. So if somebody is second and third time insisting, then we don't mind letting go, because we know that, well, I tried my best, I did my duty, but he's insisting, then how can I let him down? So that may be our tendency at the end of it. But Prahlad, when the Lord himself is insisting, he doesn't sway from what he says. So same way in our case, we may do service, but in a subtle way, we may like a service, and then we may get attached to it. But then when we are asked to do something else, then we may want to avoid doing it. So actually, when we talk of unmotivated service, it means that the service that we do, the consciousness is important, and also that it should be done whatever we are told we should be able to do. So for instance, if we are told to, say, clean the toilet, and if you are also told to give address 1,000 people, our inclination may be that we want to address 1,000 people. But if the spiritual master or our authority has told us to clean the toilet, then actually both are on the transcendental level. But when we are told to do one, then that actually becomes a higher purpose, higher principle. So in this, the quality of the service is in a transcendental level, the quality of the service is all the same. It is only our consciousness which will determine whether, and the spirit, the motivation, which will determine whether we and how we are approaching it. So externally, if somebody is cleaning the toilet, or somebody is giving a class, or somebody is doing deity worship, or somebody is out distributing books, one doesn't say anything. It's, of course, it says that somebody is doing the service. But for Krishna, what he's seeing is the devotion. And the devotion lies in following instructions. Because ultimately, our success in spiritual life solely and only depends on pleasing the Vaishnavas and the spiritual master. So by attracting the mercy of the spiritual master and the acharyas and Krishna, can we make spiritual advancement. There is no other way. So whatever we are doing, anything that we do, it is only with that purpose in mind. And when we say that purpose, means one may say that there is a motivation there. No, there is. It is, the motivation is to please. Yes, that is our when we find real pleasure in serving. But in that, if that should be the end of it all, it is not a means to a further end. The end is that the service is to please. Now, it's also not that the pleasure must be observed, that the pleasure must be seen by the authorities. So in some way it should be acknowledged. No, even if that desire is there, then that is not, there is a certain motivation, that subtle motivation of being, of feeling something. So therefore, the subtleties lie in the fact that we should be consistently watching our motivations. And Srila Prabhupada said that on the path of bhakti, there are two sections, Pancharatrika Vidhi as well as Bhagavad Dharma. So Pancharatrika Vidhi is services which are related to the deities. Bhagavad Dharma is the process of hearing and chanting. So both are essential. But the Bhagavad Dharma is has to be very carefully understood, because if we do not understand constantly, or if we do not read, if we do not understand the essence of our philosophy, then a time may come that even our service to the deities may be may actually become very dry and become less attractive. Our whole it may become a materialistic vision. I remember His Holiness Radhanath Maharaj has mentioned this several times, quoting Prabhupada, by saying that if we don't attentively hear and chant, then a day will come when you will be looking at Radha Gopinath and saying that why is this has become such a burden, and my service has become a burden, why is it only I have to do this? And then we'll find reasons to say that I have been doing for so many years, but now somebody else should be doing it. I have now graduated to a higher level. I have now come to a stage where I have to do other duties. I have to guide other people. So, you know, consciously we derive hierarchies. And that there's an urge which comes within us, because pride and prestige gets embellished when you have a hierarchy. If you're all on the same, if you actually believe and act on the same level, then there's no question of hierarchy. Then there's no question of having an influence over others. So that desire becomes overwhelming. So that is where, when Prabhupada said that when we, so the reason we need to read and chant is that when we are constantly hearing regularly about the critical essence of this principle of that we are all the same, and then the service, transcendental level, the service is unmotivated, uninterrupted, and it should be done. The consciousness is very important. Otherwise, we may have this tendency to, and we see, and then the judgment in our minds about various people will be on the basis of material vision. And material vision is generally according to success and failure. You know, this term success and failure is a materialistic term. Basically, if we judge a success by someone who has done something, who has achieved something tangible, you know, who has earned fame, glory, who has made a lot of money, or who's become a very famous singer, who's in whatever occupation he or she is, has done something really spectacular. And a failure is someone who's made an effort but is a nobody. So this is the way we judge, and then consciously or unconsciously this becomes our way to look at people. And everywhere we see, like in a family, if there are three children, look, I say, you know, my son, he's done, you know, he's done his he's done his master's, and then, you know, he did his undergraduate in Princeton, and he's done his PhD in Harvard. And supposing my younger son is just a college dropout, you know, we will just gloss over that fact. So we immediately like to, you know, bring up the fact that what is positive and what we consider positive will be someone who's done very well. Or if somebody is doing very well settled, immediately say, okay, he's in London, he's an investment banker, very well settled. The other person may be working in some company, you know, you may just mention or not even mention. So we start judging things according to, and we appreciate things, we also respect people accordingly, and then it becomes too late for us because we just get sucked into it. Well, here there are so many examples. For instance, if we say, would we say Jatayu was a failure? Jatayu in Ramayana, there was a famous lecture which was given by His Holiness Radhanath Maharaj when he said, you know, whether is Arjun a success and Jatayu a failure? Because Arjun won the war and Jatayu lost his life. No, Jatayu, we understand, is absolutely, is a pure devotee, is very successful. Because the there's no such thing as a failure. For a devotee, there is no such thing as a failure. That is the most heartening and reassuring thing. Actually, it took me some time to understand because I used to avoid giving class. But when I understood that it doesn't matter, it's not a failure. If you do it as a service, then it is a success. So Krishna is not interested in the results. This is a principle which is actually reassuring and also a revelation, because we are not used to it. But once we understand that, then we just concentrate on the quality of the service and the activity and whom it is pleasing, whose opinion counts. We don't have to look for millions of opinions. We have to look for the opinions of the people who count and who are valuable to us. And who are valuable will depend on how we lead our life. If we are following a Krishna conscious approach, then we will really value and respect those, irrespective of bank balance or, you know, personality or education and things like that. So therefore, we can see that Jatayu was as successful as Arjun. Or would we say that Shabri, what a waste of life. You know, whole life she was in the forest, and just and then Lord Ram just met for a few minutes. Oh, we see and we understand that that was, even if Lord Ram had not met, hypothetically, it was a success, because that desire to, and she was leading an enthusiastic life every day. Imagine the enthusiasm a person can generate day in and day out, for month in and month out, year in and year out, for decades, and living in that expectation that the Lord will come, and very happy, not rejected. So the Lord, of course, fulfilled her desire. Or even Srila Prabhupada's case. Srila Prabhupada went to Jhansi, and where he made only one disciple, but he started with such a big effort. You know, he made so many preparations, spent a year there, and then he was kicked out from there. You know, he was there was some political drama, and then he was asked to go. Some powerful people, the wife of the governor, she took that place, and he was asked to go. But he was not disheartened. In fact, that time, I think it was that time that he also heard that his factory had been stolen, everything was robbed in that pharmacy. But he didn't get disheartened. He was, because he was on that level where his service was not determined by number of devotees, not determined by material, tangible progress of saying that I've opened 5 centers and I've got 20 people coming. No. That may be secondary. That is something which is an encouragement and you may increase your service. But the principle was that my spiritual master wanted me to preach, and this was only a stepping stone for him to ultimately go overseas. Then when he went overseas also, we know what happened in the first year. You know, it is easy to see in posterity, and we know it's like everything was it's like a fairy tale. But no, it is certainly organized by Krishna, but there was tremendous difficulties and challenges. He went through practically nobody. We talk of the matchless gift store, and then people were coming and all, but we don't realize that he reached in September. We know it took more than a month to reach Boston, and he got 2 heart attacks. But from September 1965 till next June, when he really started initiating devotees, that was almost a year, was an extremely difficult. You know, he was all practically killed. He was thrown out by that a person was crazed because of drugs. He had to literally run down three floors. And if you see that building in the Bowery, those staircases are the old style staircases. So down the fire escape, I mean, it's a pretty steep, the old buildings. So for an old man to do that, I mean, and he didn't lose any enthusiasm at all. He just continued with the same urgency. For how many months you were sitting under that one tree in Tompkins Square Park chanting, and we just see the end result, but we don't know what it must be literally going every day, sitting under the tree, taking out his kartals in a strange place, people giving strange looks. Perhaps he must have been accosted by policemen and others who must have definitely, and people making all kinds of remarks. So it must be a hostile, intimidating environment also at times. No success at all. But unless someone is completely convinced or someone is mad, why would that do that? And he was so convinced about what he was doing that he's come to give, not to take. And eventually Krishna rewarded. So we can see that the activity is what counts. And in Prabhupada's case, there was, of course, it was historical that, you know, what he achieved in 12 years, we all know. But even if that is not the case, and there are so many acharyas who have actually he led a pure life, and they were Babajis, and they have not necessarily impacted the world in this way, because that is all organized by the Lord as to who will do what in the entire progress towards as the Kali Yuga progresses. So we have to take heart from that our purpose is to understand our service, our own self. The swadharma is crucial, just like sugar is, the swadharma is to be sweet, or the chili is, swadharma is to be hot. You can't have sugar being hot and chili being sweet. That is adharma. So same way, when we understand that our natural propensity is to serve, and then in that service, there are interim or subordinate rules or subordinate requirements, which if somebody is a grihastha working, somebody is a brahmachari who is full-time in the temple, we have our own individual different sub-occupations or sub-responsibilities. But within the overall service of trying to keep Krishna in the center, that becomes the most important aspect. And that cannot be done by our own mind. It cannot be just done according to our whims. That is where we have guidance from scriptures and a process which is laid down by Srila Prabhupada, the purpose of ISKCON basically, to help how a Vaishnava can lead a life in whatever circumstances, whether in which country and which background and which gender, which education, nothing counts. So in that sense, actually, this is really, you can see, is the only hope that the world has. You know, we sometimes look at the challenges when we are looking at from our level down here, and say that, well, where is, we may have a few tens of thousands of people, or maybe a few lakhs of people who are serious about spiritual life and what happens all over the world and see what is, and there are 7 billion people. But if you see that everybody is understanding, they're trying to have a United Nations, but there's no unity because there are caste systems, class systems, people are looking in hierarchies. So Krishna consciousness in principle breaks all that. It's only that it is not so simple. It is simple, but it is not so simple also, it's both. So it is simple to understand, but not so simple to follow. And that's where the attraction for devotees is to double our energy and to go all out as to spread the mission of the Lord. And the last point I wanted to say is that also Krishna says that one is about the service, what is our need, and as in Bhagavad Gita he says we have a right to perform our duty but not to be attached to the fruits. So the results are what counts, but also we should not be attached to not doing our duty, because there is also the other extreme that in this progress we may mistake saying that doing any duty or doing anything is actually maya, or that we may avoid our responsibility. No, Krishna shows by his own example that he himself, being the supreme controller, still he creates, he maintains and he destroys the universe, and still he is not attached. So actually doing our duty, in fact not doing our duty, is attachment. Because then we are sticking to our own thoughts and not taking the following. So detachment would be just simply trying to please the Lord. And how do we please the Lord? By following His instructions. And if He says that we should do our duty, but in a particular consciousness, that's what we need to do. So it's a positive statement. It is not that we kind of avoid doing our duty also. So essentially, to get this consciousness, the purpose of our life should be to bring the practices of our daily life in such a way that they can remind us of Krishna consciousness in one way or the other. We cannot stray too far wherever we are. We may be physically going here and there, but at heart and in our mind, somehow if we can create an environment around us where we are always connected to that. And it doesn't have to be tangible, it is from the heart, which means that whom does your heart tick for? You know, whom, where, what excites you most, what pleases you most, what news please you most. And other things you may digest for information, which is part of your occupation or your need to, which is maybe necessary in the discharge of some other responsibilities. But the essence is to not deviate from the practices of regularly chanting, trying to be as attentive as possible, trying to read the Srimad Bhagavatam and other scriptures, and following the instructions and example of the other devotees. So I'll stop here. And if there's any questions, any? Okay. Granthraj Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.